And the legendary Geena Davis!
Thank you.
Sorry,
thank
you. Were you startled by your own introduction, Geena?
I'm overwhelmed.
Oh, well, no need to be overwhelmed. We should be overwhelmed. It's so great to have you here. Your exhibition is all about positive gender representation, and it's not on its own. Like, this aligns perfectly with the work you do with your foundation. Tell us a bit about it.
So the exhibition is incredible. I just toured it today, and it's amazing costumes and memorabilia and really rare film clips and things like that from the goddesses of the big screen.
Now, one of the films being featured is Thelma and Louise, which really put women in the driver's seat. And you speak in such high regard of your co-star, Susan Sarandon. How did this movie change things for women in Hollywood?
Well, it certainly changed my life. Susan changed my life more than anyone ever. And it was because I had never spent extended time in the presence of a woman who moves through the world the way she does, which is very comfortably. She is not apologizing for existing. And I was raised to be the most insanely polite person on the planet. And it was an incredible experience to witness that. And see, nobody's reacting badly to the fact that she doesn't preface everything with, this is probably a stupid idea, but... So that was amazing. But also the reaction to the movie, none of us expected that it would strike a nerve the way it did. It was really overwhelming.
What about some other characters that you've worked with throughout your career? There's been so many. Are there any that you didn't get along with that potentially you would have liked to throw off a cliff?
I'd drive them off a cliff to jump out of the car myself, yes. Yeah, sure, there were a couple, yes, but...
Would you like to name that, names?
No. I name a couple of people in my book, but no. Most... Everybody that I've worked with is incredible, wonderful, wonderful people. So, and I married some of them.
Well, you're being very polite, and you released your memoir last year, which is titled Dying of Politeness. Can you explain how politeness was killing you?
Well, I tell a very literal instance in the book why I chose that name, because when I was 8 years old, I was in a car in the back seat with my parents, and my great uncle Jack was driving at 99 years old at night in the dark. And every once in a while, he would veer into the oncoming lane and then veer back. Fortunately, thank God, nobody was coming in the other direction. And my mom picked me up and put me in the middle, thinking maybe I would die less if I was sitting between my parents when the head-on collision happened. And sure enough, he veers into the other lane, and now a car is coming. Still nobody says a peep. At the last instant, great Aunt Marion says, a little to the right, Jack. Veers over just in time to save our lives. And only later was I able to realize that my parents would rather have died and taken me with them than risk saying something impolite to great Uncle Jack, who didn't matter if he died because he was 99. Anyway, that's how I was raised.
What is it with being the good girl and not taking up too much space? I mean, I think you've spoken about it before because you're a tall woman, 6 foot flat.
6 foot, yep.
I can kind of relate to this as well because I'm 5'10". Do you feel comfortable now in your own skin?
Oh, yeah, I do. You know, and partly that is because I had to learn a sport. You know, when I had to learn baseball for a league of their own, I'd never really played sports at all. And it turned out that I was kind of good at it, thank God, because of the movie, I had to look like I knew what I was doing. And that's when I started to feel like, wow, wait a minute. It actually is okay to take up this much space in the world. I could do things with my body. And it really changed my self-worth, you know, my feelings of self-value.
Yeah, it must be an extraordinary experience. And it was an extraordinary movie, by the way, but I wanted you to clear up this rumour that... Is it true there was a scene cut from that film that might have changed the relationship between your character and Tom Hanks' character?
Yes, yeah. There was a scene where we kissed on the pitcher's mound at night one night, and people... Test audiences didn't like it. And also, the real women that played baseball during World War II were like, that would never happen. We would never cheat on our husband while he was away at war. So I thought you were going to say clear up whether you dropped the ball on purpose or not.
Actually, that was my next question. Could you clear up whether you dropped the ball on purpose or not?
No, I will not. I will not. I know the answer, and I will never tell.
A League of Their Own is being remade into a TV series, which is very exciting. Does this mean we have more Beetlejuice on the way?
Yes.
Can we break that
yes.
scoop?
Beetlejuice 2.
You know, yes, Beetlejuice 2 is happening. No, I have no idea. But for like a decade at least, people have been talking about Beetlejuice 2, or maybe more, and... I believe it when I'm in it, but not till then. You know, but I'm a little worried that maybe ghosts don't age, and one of us, Alec Baldwin and I, one of us has aged a lot, so I don't know how that's going to work out.
The Goddess exhibition at Acme opens tomorrow. You can find all the information on our website. Geena, it's been a delight. Thank you so much for speaking to us.
Thank you. That was a lot of fun. Thanks.